So I'm going to start things kind of from the top and explain a few things and backtrack a little bit and hopefully go a little behind a little before where this presentation should ideally take place. This is music theory from the barbershop slant and as taught by the Harmony University model. So it's geared up to be done in 6 days, with the sixth day being a review and the seventh day being the test. So it's a lot kind of right at once. So you'll see here that we're on the basic Barbershop Harmony Society website. And we're going to go over to education and scroll down to music theory, or click through education and get to this music theory portal. Now, this music theory portal was written by barbershoppers for barbershoppers. And this is the basic landing page that you'll see here from my desktop. So you'll see that music theory has 1, 2, 3, 4 levels, generally done by Roman numerals. But here are all of the music theory lessons that we would give to a director's college student, applicant. So it's basic musicianship in music theory level 1. Theory 2 delves into more of chords and triads and sevenths. Theory 3, more how music is analyzed in sevenths and voice leading and such. And music theory 4 delves farther into some rare chords and ninths and thirteenths and added sixth chords and such like that. For music theory 1, and what we're focused on in this particular lesson, we will continue with where we left off, which is the basics of rhythm, or how music is organized. Music theory 1, day 1, which we skip over, presuming you already know that and have done that, is the very basics of music theory, building blocks such as the 5-line staff, treble clef, bass clef, and the note names of the clef. So we presume you have either seen that or know that already and are familiar with the grand staff and how we're going to be seeing things. So let's go back to the basic landing page. If you were to come through the music, through the Barbershop Harmony Society's basic portal, you'd go to the music theory tab and land here. Music theory 1 would already be opened, and we could go to music theory 1, day 2. If there are any questions on how to find that, text those in the box to Rick, and we'll make sure that everyone is able to find this. Now, again, the beauty of this program design is that it's set up to be done at your own pace. So if you miss anything, if you're stumped by anything, you can go back and you can review these and you can get up to scratch and where you need to be. So we open this tab right here, it will launch this page that I already have up. So here is Harmony University Music Theory 1, Level 1, Day 2, or Rhythm Basics. Music is measured in time and in duration by rhythm. So the very first things we're going to do is basically show you how music is set up, which music timing is. It's kind of a fascinating story as to how we got to this point, but even added bar lines is a huge, fascinating history lesson. But for now, we're going to glaze over that history in brief passing. We're going to say that these are measures. Music is organized by measures. So you have these dividing lines between the staff to give you basic units of measurement. So these measures, sometimes referred to bars or bar lines, are going to be in every piece that you see. Now, in barbershop music, we tend not to draw the bar line all the way through, but this bar line is always aligned on a horizontal plane and vertical plane right here. So this bar line, as if represents the bar line drawn all the way through the treble clef and through the bass clef. You won't see this one here and this one here, for example. So you'll see that bar line drawn straight up and down. And on piano music, actually, usually is drawn all the way through the staff, all the way through the grand staff. Again, the grand staff being treble clef plus bass clef bracketed together. So here's our basic measure, or 4 measures right here. And we're going to add notes and words and rhythms into these measures. And how this is done is by these circles with stems drawn on the page. So from the very far left here, in this example, we'll see whole note, half note, and quarter notes. Now notice that the values of these notes decreases by half each time they are manifest. So a whole note counts for the entire measure right here. So this whole note represents four counts in this system. And the half note, again, the same thing, just divided directly in half and quarter notes farther from there. So we could say pie, donuts, pies and donuts, to kind of show you that the value for those decreases by half each time. So pie, two, three, four, donuts, pies and donuts, just to give you an idea of how the time is. So again, the whole note, counting for four counts, uses the entire measure, whereas the half notes, again, divided in half, use half, and quarter notes, again, one quarter apiece. Now you can subdivide even further than this in eighth notes and sixteenth notes. So pies and donuts, pies and donuts, to give you the one, two, three, four, or it'd be one and two and three and four. And so each time this shows up, it gets even smaller. So sixteenth notes, just further subdividing these measures, one E and a two E and a three E and a four E and a, and you can divide even farther than that in 32nd notes and 64th notes. Barbershop music tends to not use, and may I add, most modern music doesn't really divide farther than 16th notes as a general rule. There may be some exceptions to that, but generally speaking, these are the most common in the family of notes that you'll see. And for another way of looking at it, we're going to see this chart right here, and hopefully you can see this. This may be a little bit pixelated, but here is the half note on the top, and then you can see on either side that this is equal, these two half notes equal this whole note, and farther down you go, the more subdivisions that are in the piece. And another way of looking at it, we see this pie chart here. So there's your whole note, one, two, three, four. Half note would be half the measure on each side, and then quarter notes, and then the divisions would just get smaller and smaller, dividing the pie wedges into smaller pieces. So how many of these notes can fit in each particular measure? Now this is the part where we add in a concept called meter. Meter is how songs are classified, and how many beats fit in each measure. So let's start out with common time. Common time refers to notes being divided into two equal parts. This quarter note can be divided directly in half to be two eighth notes, for example, as we saw earlier up here on the chart. One quarter note is the same as two eighth notes. In common time, the quarter note is the basic building block because it divides directly in half. We'll get to a more compound time in a second, but this is common time far more common, hence its name, than compound meter is. Now the time signature indicates which meter will be used in a song. We're looking at 2-4 time signature or meter, it could be synonymous terms, in this particular example of I Love You Truly, which is taken, by the way, from the Free and Easy website. So here's another song for you. I Love You Truly would be subdivided into quarter notes and eighth notes, or if we were to use something that would use the entirety of this measure, we would use a half note. So there's two numbers, one on top of another, in all time signatures, in all meters. The top note refers to how many counts are in every measure, the bottom note referring to which note gets the count. So in this particular one, we're going to look at there are two counts in every measure, and the quarter note will get the count. Now there are a number of ways of looking at that, but we will see some of those examples below. So two counts in every measure, and the quarter note gets the count. Let's see if this particular measure does that. So here is one quarter note, and here is two eighth notes. Here are two eighth notes. So one count, and then these two share one count. One count, and these two share one count, and there's your dividing line of your meter, of your measures. Now, unless the meter changes, and if the meter changes, we would see it right here before the next bar line. Unless this meter changes, we suppose that the entire song will be utilizing these two concepts of two counts per measure, quarter note getting the count. Unless there is a meter change, which would be right before the next bar line, we assume that this will be on every line. In fact, in songs, we don't generally show this again. We suppose that you remember it through the rest of the song. So it reduces clutter in music notation. So the two numbers displayed, we've already explained this. In this particular excerpt, the combinations of quarter notes and eighth notes have to add up to two full counts, otherwise the measure is incomplete. So again, we've explained how we counted up those two counts. Now, this concept of meter goes really, really pretty deep. And if you want to learn any more farther about that, I put in this link, I believe this is a Wikipedia link, talking about meter and how many other different ways of divisions there are, and all sorts of kinds of information and history as to how we come to that. This is a good succinct summary of time signature, but the rabbit hole does go pretty deep if you want to learn some more, and there's a lot of fascinating discovery, again, just how we get to staff lines and how we get to bar lines that has evolved over centuries. Compound meter. Compound meter is a time signature where the beat is divided into groups of three. So again, common time and simple meter divided into two, and compound meter divided into groups of three. Let's see what we understand by these groups of three. A song in 6/8 time is an example of a song that is divided into more than just two counts. So the beats are different in a 6/8 song than they are in a 2/4 or 4/4 common time. So compound meter, a song in 6/8 time, a good example of this is there are two strong beats in the measure, both getting three counts each. So this is a song published from the published library called McNamara's Band, which is a society arrangement. And this will show us our divisions within the measure of using three counts. Or, oh, me name is McNamara, I'm the leader of the band. So we can't really divide this into two because there are six counts in every measure. And the eighth note gets the beat. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. This measure here being the incomplete measure since it's a pickup measure. So let's count and make sure there are six counts in every one of these measures. So here's 1, 2, barring by eighth notes, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So we show the quarter note is getting two counts. Again, because we're in 6/8 time, eighth note getting the count. So how many eighth notes would there be in a measure if we broke all these up? There would be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So the pulse in 6/8 is grouping of threes because we're in compound meter. So we have 1, 2, 3, and 1, 2, 3. For a bracketed version of it, we could look at it this way. We have 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. So we're going to see the pulse going 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2. Oh, me name is McNamara, I'm the leader of the band. So this shows that there are two main beats per measure, measured by the dotted quarter note. 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, which is a faster way of counting. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, because there are it's an easier way to count through it. 6/8 time is probably the most common of compound meters, although there are other meters in compound that exist, such as 9/8 time and 12/8 time. 9/8 time, we do the same thing as 6/8 time, just have one more pulse. So instead of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 9/8 time would add one more pulse to that, or 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. 12/8 time doing very much the same thing. There is an example in The Beautiful Dreamer of a 9/8 time, or beautiful dreamer, wake unto me, starlight and dewdrops, wake unto me. So have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, beautiful dreamer, wake unto me, and that kind of thing. And you can click here later to watch this example by Nightlife, our 1996 International Champion Quartet, sing Beautiful Dreamer, although they do take some rhythmic liberties with the particular tune. Augmentation dots. Augmentation dot is kind of the lazy man's way, the shorthand way of writing the same meter, but just using less ink. Specifically, an augmentation dot is used, and what it does is it lengthens the value of the note by half again, the note that it represents. So let's look at this example that's provided below. We have a half note. A half note would normally get two counts. However, if we add an augmentation dot by it, it's going to increase the note by half again its value. So since the value of a half note is two counts, this augmentation dot counts for one count. Or another way of writing it, in the example next to it, is a half note tied to or in addition to this particular note. So 1, 2, 3, or 1, 2, 3. The augmentation dot, again, being a shorthand as to how you write it. So here below is a grid of augmentation dots and their shorthands. So again, this one that we showed above being the half note with an augmentation dot being equal to or the same value as a half note plus a quarter note. A dotted quarter note, which would normally get one count with an augmentation dot next to it, is going to get one and a half counts, and similar depending on how which note it reflects. So a dotted whole note, a whole note would normally get four counts. A dotted whole note increases it again by half again its volume, or two value. So a dotted whole note would get six counts. Again, since music is math, we've heard this term a lot. Then this chart shows us how these augmentation dots work. This is example below shows again how we would use the augmentation dot to simplify the number of notes per measure. So this number, this measure to the right, is really just a more complex way of writing this. This is a simplified, easier shorthand way of showing you what comes next to it. So there are, you're seeing less notes, and for vocal musicians, there's less of a chance to make an error. Let's move on to rests. Just as there are symbols for notes, there are also symbols for rests. You'll note that there are very, very similar flight pattern to what we saw earlier with our note chart. In the rest chart, let's scroll back down to where this is. In the rest chart, we look at a whole rest, half rest, quarter rest, eighth rest, 16th rest, 36, and again, divided. So notice the pattern here of division exactly in half, exactly in half, exactly in half. So if we were to add a row down to the bottom of this, we would double the number of rests that are in this particular line. And now notice one small thing about the whole rest. I'm going to increase the size here so you can see this more clearly. The whole rest and the half rest, they look very, very similar. The whole rest is kind of the childish way of remembering this is as a top hat. If this were a magician's top hat, you can see the brim right here where you would put it, and this is kind of upside down as you were going to pull a rabbit out of this. But the magician's top hat holds more water if it's held this way. If you were to pour water on top of the hat, the water would spill off. So you can see the lines on the bottom and the lines on the top. So whole rest, half rest, doubled half rest, quarter rest. Four of these make up one of these. Very, very similar in scope and nature to the value of notes. One of the characteristics of barbershop music is four-part harmony with relatively few solo passages. So indeed, some barbershop songs contain no rests at all. And sometimes barbershoppers will tend to use rests as their way of saying, breathe right here. Let's move on to the worksheet, because the worksheet is going to take a lot of these concepts, which may be confusing at first glance, and show you them in a little bit more detail so that you can get some practice on this. So let's go over a time signature exercise we have below here. Measures in 2/4 and 4/4 time. So let's see if we can learn what we defined earlier about time signature and meter and apply it to this particular worksheet. So if we were to identify the meter of each of these measures, we would look below and we would have to count up how many counts or how many beats or the value, the note values, in each of these measures. So we look at this particular measure, this again defined by where the bar lines are, divided by where the bar lines are. We can see there are one, two, counting this, these two eighth notes as one count, one, two, three, four. So we would call this a 4/4 time signature. The measure after it, also again one, two, and then half note being three and four. So we're going to get four counts in this bar. So again, another 4/4 bar. This particular measure after it says one quarter note and two eighth notes, which is a 2/4 bar. And indeed, I think this is the rest of the line follows a similar format. We've got one, two, one, two, and one, two. So when does it switch? How can you tell? Let's try some more exercises. And rather than being one division here, this is going to jump back and forth. So we can see we have one count here, one count here. So this is a 2/4 bar. One and two. Another 2/4 bar. One, two, three, and four. A 4/4 bar. One, two, three, and four. Very similar. 4/4 bar. One, two, three, four. Another 4/4 bar, one, two, a 2/4 bar, and then a whole note being one, two, three, and four. Now let's try the same thing with compound meter. And compound meter, again, because it's a little bit more rare, particularly in barbershop, is going to take a little bit more time in getting used to how it's beamed and how it's grouped. So let's look at these bars below and see if we can catch how many which time signature these are. So we have one, two, three, four notes, but they're all dotted quarter notes. So dot meaning these are going to get, again, half the value of the note that precedes it. So this particular note is going to get one, two, three eighth notes value. One, two, three eighth notes value. One, two, three, et cetera. So we have four dotted quarter notes, each getting three counts. So we really have 12 eighth notes basically in this particular bar. So we can look at this as 1, 2, 3, 4, 12, 8 time. Again, you're going to see that the quarter note is going to get the count value in this. Dun, 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 dun. And you're going to see that that's where that's going to fit. Measure after it, we see two dotted quarter notes. Again, each getting three eighth notes worth. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So we're going to call that one a 6/8 bar. This particular one here, we've got the same thing, except for this one is twice the value of this one. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 eighth notes value, and 1, 2, 3 eighth notes value. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. We can go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So we've got three different tempi for this particular three bars. Again, we're going to jump back to the same note values we see here, another 6/8 bar. And this particular one, we have two dotted half notes. Again, the dotted half note getting one additional count value for what it has. So 1, 2, and another 3. So we have 3. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Note the division within these measures, 6, 8, 9, 8, 12, 8, compound meter usually groups to the eighth note because it's the easiest way to see where the note value lie. And that's consistent with looking back down to McNamara's band. You see that things are generally grouped to where the eighth note value lies. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. If I'm moving too fast, please shout out to Rick and let me know if I can perhaps explain something a little bit more clearly or a little bit more in depth. Let's get some practice with augmentation dots. Augmentation dot, again, giving half the value of what the note was before it. So we can rewrite these measures using augmentation dots. Let's look at the example provided below. Now, again, an augmentation dot is going to group together two notes.
Can I interrupt real quick?
Mm-hmm.
Sorry about that. Brian Lynch wants to know, in the final measure you're just looking at, why is it counted in eighths?
Why is it counted in eighths? It can be counted either way, but there are so many counts in this measure that we wouldn't see it really any other way but in compound meter. Compound meter is going to deal a lot with the dotted quarter note and the dotted half note as the basic metric for analyzing the notes. So again, you've got this particular one here. We could renotate this another way using a half note tied to a dotted quarter note, but it would be confusing because the basic measurement is the eighth note. The basic measurement is the dotted quarter or the eighth note in this. So we generally use those. In fact, a lot of barbershop music will subdivide measures that are cut in half like this, rather than doing a half note tied to a dotted quarter note, because a half note doesn't really, not that it doesn't exist in 6/8 time, but it's very difficult to try and read things in 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So we would see this as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Brian, does that answer the question?
Yeah, and it's kind of taken out of context. If you're reading that last measure of two dotted halves in the context of everything else that preceded it on that line, that makes sense. I guess I was reading this in single exercise. I came across
right.
that as a single
and
exercise, yeah.
Now, again, this is just an exercise to help you identify
yeah.
what the compound meter is for this particular one. There are certainly dotted quarter notes in 4/4 time. We use those as, again, shorthand just to avoid writing a lot of ties and additional note values. But you're going to see in compound meter, you're going to see a lot of augmentation dots because it's much faster to write out a quarter note with a dot than a quarter note with a tie to another eighth note, because this measure would be twice as long. It would take up twice as much space. And the augmentation dot has just kind of been developed as a way of, again, shorthand, a way to write that in a way that's succinct, that's easy to spot. And we can look at this example below to see how valuable that is. Look at the second measure right here. You got the note of the same value tied to this note, and this note of the same value tied to this note, or the same pitch level, excuse me. So these note tied to this note, and this note tied to this note, when it would be much easier to write this note as a dotted quarter note and this note as a dotted quarter note. Then you would say, da, 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 da. And this extreme example on the last one being these are all the same note value. It just becomes confusing to know how long to hold that when it would be easier to write a dotted half note and just have it call 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 6, because this is all the same note value. So we could rewrite this as keep these all different because they're different pitch values. But these two, since they're the same pitch value, the tie just gets in the way. And this tie just gets in the way, since it's the same pitch value. And if there were words here, Brian, that would probably make it a little bit more easier to understand. Here's an example in simple meter of the same type of example, where you've got quarter note. Again, we'd be in 4/4 here, so the quarter note is going to get the beat, not the eighth note. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. So we're going to be looking at this as going 1, 2, 3, 4. We could put a dot on this and leave the 16th as it is. 1, 2, 1, 2, and 1, 2, and a 3, 4, or 1, 2, a 3, 4, because this note is the same note. 1, 2, a 3, 4, or 1, two, and a three, four. Since they're the same note tying together, it's just shorthand to write an augmentation dot there. And the same way we could do here, we would write one, two, three. Rather than doing a quarter note tied to a quarter note, the same note, we could just write this as a half note and be much tidier about the music notation. Same thing right here where you've got a quarter note tied to an eighth note. You could take the quarter note, put an augmentation dot, and then have this one, one, and then two from the augmentation dot in this note, three and four. Now here's another kind of interesting anomaly here. This wouldn't actually exist in music, but one measure in this exercise does not contain four counts. So we're going to seek and destroy this impossible measure and circle and correct it. Again, all these worksheets are designed so that you can just print them off, and so you can label and circle and scratch and cross out and move and work on these as an actual worksheet. For the purposes of this presentation, we're going to keep it just how it is right here. So let's look at this first measure and see if we can count up four counts in this particular measure. We have one count here plus half a count from the augmentation dot. So one and a half and two, or so we'd say one and two. And then we have a half a count here, a whole count here, and a half a count here. So there's one count, two counts, and then three, four counts. So one and a half plus a half plus a half, so two and a half, three and a half, and then four. Another way of counting through it. Let's go backwards to forwards here. We got one quarter rest and one quarter note, so that's one, two, and then a half note, one, two, three, four. And then we have the same thing we had at the start of this measure, so one and a half, and then two, and then a dotted eighth note and a sixteenth note, so that's three quarters of one count and one quarter of one count. So one, two, three, and four. Then we have one, two, three and a half, but rather than being an eighth note, this is a sixteenth note. So we're one sixteenth short in this second measure. So to correct this, we would change this to either an eighth note, or we could add a sixteenth rest to here and make four counts. In a different way of coming at it, we can fill the measure with the correct number of notes and rests, just to help get into practice of analyzing and discovering how many counts are in each measure. So if we were to fill a quarter, a 4/4 bar with only two notes, there's a number of different ways we could do it, right? We could write two half notes. We could write a dotted half note and a quarter note. We could write a quarter note and a dotted half rest. There's a number of different ways we can go about that. If we were to do this in one note and two rests, then we could say a half note and two quarter rests, or any combination of whatever is going to add us up to four. In a 3/4 bar, we would have to use three counts for measures. So only three counts in a measure rather than the four that we've seen or the two that we've seen before. And the quarter note still getting the beat. So in a 3/4 bar, we can have a half note and a quarter note and have it consume the full count, the full value of this 3/4 bar. In a one note and two rests, we could do one quarter note and two quarter rests. And using four notes, we could do a quarter note and four eighth notes. Or we could do a quarter note and three. No, excuse me. We do a quarter note and three eighth notes, which would be four notes to utilize the 4/3/4 bar, the full 3/4 bar. In a 2/4 bar, and you can do this exercise, we'll skip the 2/4 bar just in the interest of time, because we've kind of shown the simple value here. 6/8 time signature. If we were to do that in four notes, then, well, we could look at McNamara's band, 1, 2, 3, 4. As an example of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, as a way of seeing how many notes it would take to fill up a 6/8 bar. If we were to use three notes and one rest, we could group things a little differently. We could do three eighth notes and then one quarter rest with an augmentation dot, which would give us 1, 2, 3, and then 4, 5, 6 with the quarter rest and augmentation dot. And 4/4 bar, if we wanted to fill the whole bar with notes, with 8 notes specifically, we could write out this rhythmic pattern shown earlier. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. That whole line would be one bar because it's equal to that full 4 counts. If we wanted to do it in 3 notes, well, we could do 1, 2, 3. And again, music being math, you can just see very easily how it doesn't take much to fill up one of these bars. 4 notes with 1 rest. Well, we could divide that in half and use one of these and 4 of these, or any combination. 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, of what's going to add us up to what we need. Certainly, there's more than one way to do this exercise that I list above. This is just a way to experiment with using it. Quarter notes, eighth notes, 16th notes, notes and rests, and different ways of combining and adding to get what we need. And McNamara's Band and I Love You Truly are just different ways of combining quarter notes with eighth notes and quarter notes in groups of threes, in groups of twos, so that you can see how those are combined together. In this particular lesson, and we could delve a little bit farther into subdividing measures like McNamara's Band shows. There it is. Subdividing the measure, we're very careful to show you where the beat lie. So if we're dividing into twos, 1, 2, 1, 2, rather than 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, using the dotted quarter note as the methodology and as the method of counting, it's easier to group things into 1, 2, 1, 2. So we show again, back to Brian's comment, that we've got a dotted quarter note tied to a quarter note rather than using a half note here tied to a dotted quarter note, because it makes things muddy when you're trying to find out where the measure cuts in half. 1, 2, 1, 2. So that, in a nutshell, is how we use rhythm, meter, note values, and rhythms to display pitches and values of how long to sing the note, how long to hold the rest, and how long to wait between the next note. I find that this is particularly valuable for swing charts. A lot of times we have the tendency to cut things short at the end of a 4/4 bar and a swing tune. We don't hold a note value for its entire value to the next bar. We cut out, we cheat out a little early, and then we come in a little bit early on the next bar, which makes us speed up a little bit. So knowing the full value of counts and how each one goes through is a much easier way to get through that. So do we have any questions or comments so far?
I had a question come in, Adam, real quick. Doug says, since meter is so simple and consistent through a song, why is it so difficult to maintain?
So we really have two different questions in that. You have meter and you have tempo. Now, tempo is, a short definition of tempo would be the speed with which meter is applied. So if we had 1, 2, 3, 4 versus 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, or 1, 2, 3, 4, it becomes a different concept as to how do I maintain that tempo. And really, one of the easier ways to look at that is to look at where the culprit is. So 6/8 time. Oh, me name is McNamara. I'm the leader of the band. This is an old chart, a very infamous chart to be sped off and have a song run away with you. And any of you who have been in an ensemble who has had a song more or less run away from you, run away from the director, you know how crucial that can be and how that happens. Generally speaking, when a song starts to rush, the culprit is the shorter note. And trying to make sure we get through this note fast, and if we try and speed through these notes, you'll find that the tempo can get away from you very quickly. It tends to happen more in compound meter and in meters where there's swing, which is more or less a compound meter in a different sort of way. When we do the advanced rhythm class, we can discuss a little more. So we're going to look at 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, or 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. The faster you push, the shorter of the two note values is determines what how fast the song can speed up. So holding this note slightly longer than you think you need to is a good way, is a good rule of thumb. The shorter of the two note values, drug out a little bit, is a much better way to move on. It's the holiday season. Dun, doo, doo, doo. The Happy Holidays song that my own chorus sings. We had a tendency to rush the song a little bit, and the culprit we found was in the shorter note value. It's the holidays. It's the holiday season. The faster we pushed that second note, it's the holiday season, the more we drug that second shorter note value, the better we were at maintaining integrity of the tempo. Does that answer the question? Sort of a long answer to the question, but.
I think you can move on.
Okay. That's actually the long and the short of where this lesson fits. Now, overall, in the general scheme of music theory, rhythm is very, very important. Recently deceased composer Aaron Copland said that rhythm was actually the most important element of music. And in his book, he actually explains rhythm before he explains anything else. Now, I used to think melody was just bar none the most important element of music, because if you don't have a melody, then you don't really have anything else. But I had somebody try and stump me in a class once where they were trying to prove a point, and the teacher used the song Happy Birthday and then just varied the duration of the notes in the melody, and I couldn't even tell what the song was, proving that you got to know the rhythm. If you don't know the rhythm, then everything else is going to run away. So the very basic tenets of music is rhythm. And in fact, we put rhythm before we put scales, before we put key signatures, before we put intervals. It's one of the very, very basic things, the very, very front things that we show after we tell you kind of the very basics of music. So rhythm, again, is one of the most important elements of music, and I believe it's revisited in Music Theory 2, where you have a little bit more in-depth discussion of what elements of rhythm and syncopation and swing and other elements that are probably too fast to bring up in this particular lesson. So if you want a more in-depth discussion of rhythm, Music Theory 2, Day 2, is going to jump right out at you, and it'd be a very fun lesson. And again, a lot of these lessons on the macro have their accompanying worksheets to them, where you can take a little bit more in-depth time and look and listen and experiment with yourself by using the worksheets as a nice way of getting some additional background information on the things that we're studying. The next thing in this set, in this series, is going to be Music Theory Day 3, which is scales, which is going to show us the half steps and whole steps and how we combined pitch values into major and minor scales. Are there any other questions before we call this lesson finished and complete? Anything I can illuminate on basic rhythm?
Yeah. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, this is Doug Lazar again. Yeah, one of the things that we struggle with is particularly my lead will vary the tempo, I guess, we always get hit with that we're getting better, but we used to always get hit with that in reviews.
Okay.
That,
Doug,
that
can I ask
a
couple clarifying questions?
Sure. Yeah.
Okay, so is this a swing song or a rubato free tempo song or type of song?
Usually the swing songs we get that.
So in maintaining the long phrase, one of the best things you can do is actually get a metronome. And there are a lot of apps for this, or you can just go buy a metronome. They're really cheap. But and you kind of laugh when I say I kind of laugh when I first
had
this question posed to me. You do? Nice. Very good. So one of the things that you can do, and I coached a quartet in England about this fairly recently, is they were singing a song called You've Got a Friend in Me. You've got a friend in me. You've got a friend in me. And what I was noticing was the longer the song went, it seems to just gradually speed up. And one of the culprits was is a lot of the long notes. You got a friend in me. 2, 3, 4. Those whole notes. You got a friend in me. You got, and they would kind of cheat the value of the whole note just a little bit at the end. And I found that they were just trimming just a little bit off the end of the duration of the note and coming into the next measure prematurely. And by the way, this happens to all choruses of all levels, Doug. And this particular quartet is the reigning Babs Champion Quartet. So they're not a terrible quartet.
Yeah.
So we worked on maintaining the integrity of the note values, and that seemed to help a lot, whether it's ain't misbehaving, I'm saving my love for you. One of the things, if you go on, Doug, to look at the syncopation lesson and the in-depth rhythm discussion, is it will go over mm-hmm. a little bit of those in some more detail so that you can get an idea of, hey, where is this happening and how can we find it? So if you got a click, 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 click metronome in you when you while you're practicing, particularly while you're practicing a rhythm song, it'd be much easier to find out where it is you're slowing down or where it is that you're speeding up. So it's you know there's no one to walk with all by myself. In that second note, again, it's sped up just a little bit. You tend to lose a little bit of the integrity of where the note values separate. And if it's a 4-4 bar in 1, 2, 3, 4, 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 1, 2, 3, 4, you can see where it would easily go 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. And if you've got a metronome keeping track on you, you'll notice that I sped up just a little bit on that last part. Does that make sense, Doug?
Yeah, that's good.
I think a lot of quartets, and as a quartet teaching methodology or kind of guarding yourselves, one of the best things you can do is record your quartet rehearsal. And then you can kind of take a step back from the fifth man perspective and say, well, where is it that we're speeding up or where is it that we are losing track of where the tempo goes? And if you've got a metronome going in the background, you can see which notes are being, I don't want to use the word cheated, but okay, yes, I do. Which notes don't have the full value or are having too much value added to them. And then you can, you know, find, search, and destroy. But again, that practicing against the metronome is a good way to get you up to snuff. And one other rehearsal point that might help you is something I call remove a variable. And if I were removing a variable, I would remove the melody and talk through the rhythm and see if I've got it. So rather than singing no one to walk with, I'd say no one to walk with all by myself and see where is it that I'm speeding through this if I were to just talk through this. I mean, because music being a full contact sport, you've got notes, words, rhythms, everything going at you all the time, and then you have to remember to sing in good vocal quality and all these other things. But if we take away some of those things and say, okay, we're focusing only on rhythm right here. Most choruses will do this when they're learning choreography. Guys, we're not going to sing this. We're just going to talk through this in rhythm to make sure that we have things in the right spot. Then we can go, no one to walk with all by myself. And any of those notes that are syncopated that have the tie on them or the slur on them, we crescendo through them. No one to walk with all by myself. And it helps us to remember where the pulses are and where the beats are.
Thanks a lot, Adam. Appreciate your time today, and thank you, everybody, for checking in with us today. I hope you gained something out of it. For now, we're going to conclude this session, and thanks so much.